I'm Tom Jessup. I'd like to welcome everyone to the latest installment of Talks at GS. We've got two experts with us today, Balaji Srinivasan, who's a general partner at Andreessen Horowitz, and Jerry Brito, the executive director of Coin Center, a nonprofit organization focused on digital currency research and advocacy. And it's my pleasure to be moderating the discussion today entitled The Evolution of Bitcoin. I'm going to turn it over to Balaji, who's going to walk through a presentation, and then Jerry and I will join him on stage for a brief Q&A. Balaji?
Okay. Thank you very much for that kind introduction. I'm going to talk today about just some sort of basics on Bitcoin and why we at Andreessen Horowitz think it's important. Number one, we think of Bitcoin as a protocol, right? That is to say, payments are now packets. It's not paper-based money, it's packet-based money. And that's a natural fit for the internet, where you can send packets and receive packets. It's, you know, packet-based money is good remuneration for packets. So talk about Bitcoin as a protocol. When we think of Bitcoin as a protocol, that's why we really compare it to the internet in terms of its impact, right? And so one way of thinking about the internet is, you know, before, you had to do a deal with a telco to deploy code related to information on the network backbone, okay? That's say you need to do a multi-million dollar deal, you need to do business development to get that code there. Afterwards, any node can programmatically send packets to anyone or many anyones via the internet, okay? There's, you know, the barriers to entry to writing code that dealt with information dropped, you know, like, you know, a million-fold, basically, overnight, right? And that's, you know, what we call permissionless innovation. In addition to the barriers dropping, we also integrated all these disparate networks, and those got integrated into one internet. And now today, when you think about any kind of information you transferred over the internet, whether it's books or movies or files or anything like that, and you can do all those in one, like, zip file, for example, you can send a bunch of different, you know, kinds of information at the same time. We take all that for granted. And that's the kind of transformation that Bitcoin allows. Right. So before, you needed to do a deal with a bank to, you know, transfer value in the system. But after Bitcoin, any node that can connect to the internet can now programmatically transfer value from one node to another. Right. Before, you had all these different methods of transferring value. You had cash, you had credit cards, you had wire transfers. They were applicable at different scales and frequencies of money. You know, for example, cash 1 to 100 and credit cards like, you know, 100 to 1,000 and wire transfers more than that. I mean, you're not going to be able to send a wire transfer super frequently. You can't do like 50 in a day at $20 million, right? Like back and forth. That'll set off all kinds of alarm bells and it won't happen, right? But that's the kind of thing you can do with Bitcoin. There's no limits anymore. It's totally programmable, right? It's like a unified way of transferring things. And just like with the internet, where once you had a unified way of transferring information, you could transfer books and films and files. Once you have a unified way of transferring value, okay, you can not just transfer BTC, but stock certificates, digital keys to doors, you know, like locks, anything that is of value, you can now transfer it, right? So that's mind-blowing in terms of its implications, right? So that's why we think of this as being a pretty big deal. To an end user, you know, at least as you're using Bitcoin today, you can think of it a lot like email. Anybody who has your public email address can send you email, but only you with your private key can send out from that email address. In the same way with Bitcoin, anybody who has your public Bitcoin address can send you Bitcoin, but only you with your private Bitcoin password can send out. And the one distinction is that with email, nobody who has your public email address can see your number of unread messages, right? But anybody who has your public Bitcoin address can see the amount of Bitcoin that was deposited into your inbox, your Bitcoin address, right? But otherwise, it's similar in kind of its use case. Moreover, it's also similar in the sense there's no email.com that controls email. There's no Bitcoin.com that controls Bitcoin. There's no, it's not commercial. It's open source. Every entity now can have you know, a Bitcoin wallet, and that's as big a jump as you went from like human telephone addresses, right, to machine IP addresses. You go from human bank accounts to machine Bitcoin wallets. Banking for machines, just like you now have communication for machines. That's a big step, just in its own right, right? But, you know, every entity, every device, anything that's connected to the internet can send and receive. Every country can plug into this. Every amount, it's like it doesn't matter from my, you know, 0.00001 BTC to millions of dollars. It's extensible, it's unfreezable, you know, there's nobody who can block it, and it keeps improving. Okay, so any limitation that you see on Bitcoin today, for example, 10-minute confirmation times, right? There's patches out there that reduce it to 10 seconds. There's patches out there to reduce it to millisecond confirmation times. There's patches to increase the transaction volume from, you know, roughly like 7 per second to like billions eventually. Like there's a whole roadmap that's been published, right? So Bitcoin is growing fast, right? It's a four-sided network effect. There's, you know, basically four entities here. There's the miners, who are the ones who verify transactions. They mine transactions, they print currency. There's the developers that write Bitcoin apps. They're the merchants who basically sell goods for Bitcoin, and they're the users that use Bitcoin for goods and apps. What happens here is there's a feedback loop over there where more miners mean better infrastructure, so developers feel more confident in building. The more apps that developers build and the more purchases and items that are for sale by merchants and the more users, all those things feed into Bitcoin demand, which boosts Bitcoin price, which gives more incentive to the miners. So that's that feedback loop that occurs. And there's lots of smaller loops over here, right? And this is a pretty powerful kind of thing. When you have a network effect like this that's gotten to the scale that Bitcoin has, it's very difficult to dislodge. So price, right? So now this is the one thing which is kind of confounding, right? Why is price down? And the answer is price is down because the hash rate is up. Miners are selling Bitcoin, the Bitcoin that they mine, to pay their electricity bills since they're in this, you know, neck and neck zero sum game with all these other miners. And in our view, that is what's responsible for the dumping of Bitcoin this year. Paradoxically, because there's so much interest in Bitcoin, people were selling so much to pay their electricity bills, right? With that said, the long-term price trend is actually about an order of magnitude a year for the past 5 years. So you look at the log scale, right? And that's pretty interesting, right? Going from like 1 cent to $300 in like 4 or 5 years is a pretty steep climb. Facts. So just very quickly, why is Bitcoin likely to be the winner, right? Is it modifiable? Answer is yes. There's basically BIPs, Bitcoin Improvement Proposals. There's ways to patch it, upgrade it. Is it secure? Well, you'd make $1 billion if you could crack it. Is it scalable? So, you know, there's a scalability roadmap that's published. In 20 years, the kinds of transactions, the frequency of transactions that'll be going through Bitcoin, you'll have multi-million dollar wires clearing back and forth around the world in, you know, milliseconds. Like something that's like kind of inconceivable to us today. Now, some people say, maybe I'm interested in the blockchain, not Bitcoin. The reason that we disagree that they can be separated is that in order for a blockchain to work, anything blockchain-like to work, you need a bunch of people running distributed servers. For people to run those servers, they need some incentive because the servers cost money. And that incentive comes in the token, the scarce token that is generated by the proof of works that they run, right? In this case, that's Bitcoin. Even in other blockchain-like things like Filecoin and so on, the tokens would have to be valuable, right? So we do think that, you know, the concept of a blockchain is not really separable from the concept of a digital currency. People talk about the 51% attack. We think this is oversold. There's technical countermeasures against it. Some people ask, does it have fundamental value, right? Can you eat Bitcoin? And the answer is actually yes, there is fundamental value. You can think of a slice of Bitcoin as basically, or one Satoshi, which is the smallest unit of Bitcoin, as the ability to write to the distributed ledger that is the blockchain. Right, and if writing to a database has value, a globally replicated, distributed, undeletable database, then Bitcoin has a fundamental value and you can bootstrap from there, right? And that's why we think Bitcoin will be the most important technology of this decade. Thanks.
Thanks, Balaji. Very, very interesting. And I'd like to actually give Jerry an opportunity to talk a bit about what he's doing, because the observation is that there's incredible amounts of money pouring into Bitcoin. You know, just the amount of money spent on hardware and electricity just to mine Bitcoin is significant, let alone the capital investment going into some companies like the ones Andreessen's invested in. And so, Jerry, from your perspective, with Coin Center, what are some of the hot button issues you guys are dealing with? And where do you think the regulators are in terms of legitimizing Bitcoin more broadly in the marketplace?
Sure, so let me start by saying that, so Coin Center exists because, you know, with all of that energy and resources going into Bitcoin, what we discovered is that in DC, and in fact in state capitals where a lot of the activity is happening, there's very, very little understanding of this technology. And so Coin Center exists to provide that education. And so we do the research to try to develop answers to those policy questions. We want to advocate for an approach that meets sort of the interests and the needs of the regulators while allowing for the innovation to continue. And so where does it sit right now? You could talk about it at the federal level and at the state level. A lot of the activity is happening at the state level because while Bitcoin itself can't be regulated per se because it is this protocol that exists on the internet, it's like regulating email, not something that really a government could do, you can regulate the intermediaries. And so a lot of the businesses that are building out the infrastructure around Bitcoin, so these are going to be the wallet providers, these are going to be the merchant processors, et cetera, are going to be subject to all kinds of regulations, including anti-money laundering, money transmission regulations.
Just expanding the question globally, is there, in terms of jurisdictions globally, are there any ones that you'd point to that appear to be more progressive on Bitcoin? And is there a risk of regulatory arbitrage to the extent that certain jurisdictions adapt and adopt Bitcoin before the US or other, perhaps more developed economies?
The Japanese regulators actually dug in, really understood the technology, and are now actually pretty positive on Bitcoin to the point that they're saying, okay, we're just gonna have basically like an internet-style self-regulatory bodies. Right? This is probably the most liberal country in the world in terms of Bitcoin regulation right now. So interesting place to do business. I think the UK has also made very positive noises in a different kind of way. Chancellor Osborne has said that he wants Bitcoin companies to be founded there. Hey, Jerry, you can speak to that.
I think that's right. I think there are countries that see Bitcoin as an opportunity to attract business and do that regulatory arbitrage. And so the UK certainly has an ongoing proceeding where they're taking comment from the public about how they should structure their regulatory regime to make it easier for Bitcoin and other fintech companies to come into the space. But actually, you know, as Balaji is saying, I think people have been waiting for the US for some shoe to drop. Mm-hmm. But actually, when talking to regulators, they understand the potential of this technology. I think that they have the concerns that by statute, it's their job to have those concerns. And so they're going to try to work to meet those concerns. But actually, I think the U.S. has a pretty good regime right now.
What's the killer app? What's the thing that's going to create the transmission from the hobbyist, early adopter, to people like my parents?
Bitcoin isn't the dollar, but it could be the dollar of the internet. Right. So as I say, there are niches that the dollar cannot colonize right now, or that any fiat currency cannot colonize by virtue of the fact that credit card systems were not built for micropayments. Our thesis is that it's going to start with micropayments. It's going to start with very low stakes kinds of things. Right. So for example, in-game points for video games. Get a high score in one game, you can port it over to another. Right. Shows a demand for a portable virtual currency. Right. And so like that's an obvious thing to redo with Bitcoin. So those kinds of things, like extremely low stakes activities using Bitcoin, are the kinds of things which we think are going to be first.
I think when people are in search of this killer app, and of course, if we knew the answer, we'd be out building it. I don't know about biology. I'm not building it right now myself. But you have to think about where would that come from. I think it would come from where traditional payment systems, traditional rails, don't some use case that today is not being served. And so where is that? Right now, as biology is saying, that's going to be either at the very bottom, very, very tiny transactions that are not possible, not economically feasible today, or very big transactions. So that's where I would look. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure what the answer is.
What are the most important things for folks in this audience to keep an eye on just to maintain a view on where things are headed?
I'd say basically every metric in the system is trending up other than price. And I think with price, it's something where we have that sort of artificial phenomenon of miners piling into jack-up hash rate has pushed down price. You have like a weird anti-correlation kind of mm-hmm. thing going on there. With that said, I don't think the business models have been found yet. I think it's something where people are still figuring out what happens when every transaction fee is sent to zero. Where do you make your money?
One of the things that's interesting to me is when I first sort of started learning about Bitcoin, it was sort of on bad terms. What is the industry doing, the ecosystem, you guys, what are you guys doing, what can you do to increase the profile that these are legitimate businesses, that they serve a broader public purpose? What are some of the things that you think are going to maybe address some of those negative connotations?
I think it's education. I think it's engaging regulators and elected officials in a dialogue, and something that we're doing. And I think that's something that's going pretty well.
Yeah, and so my thought on that is I think actually we've done a pretty good job over the last 18 months of education. And you know, certainly like the conversation is vastly different today. Like entrepreneurs now know that they can build with confidence, and you're going to see a lot more of them coming.
I'd love to thank Balaji and Jerry for their time today. Obviously, very exciting space. Thank you for your time. Hopefully, we can do more of these.